మేడం స్టార్ట్ చేసాను ఇంకా
morning everyone. I, Shailaja, extend a warm welcome to all for the first session of TED NACC sponsored conference on impact of best practices in quality enhancement in higher education institutions. Today, I find immense pleasure in introducing our honorable resource person, Dr. P. Anil Kumar, who had been working as a lecturer in various government colleges for more than 20 years and is currently working as academic officer in CCE Andhra Pradesh. He published more than 60 publications in international and national journals. He has vast experience in guiding many colleges related to MAC activities. We are fortunate enough to have the person associated with this conference. We are really thankful to him for taking the time out of his busy schedule to attend this session. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Now I welcome Dr. P. Anil Kumar, sir. Sir, please take on the session.
Thank you, madam. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thanks for giving this opportunity to the management of KBN College. And thank my friends there also. As the given topic is the effects of internal quality assurance on Indian higher educational institutions. As you all know very well that IQAC plays a very important role in a total and a comprehensive quality assessment within the institution. So here, the very important you may call it as a task force within the college is internal quality assurance itself. It plays a very important role for providing end-to-end solutions for the academics mostly, and of course their administration also. In this connection, I would like to present on effects of internal quality assurance on Indian higher education institutions. Okay, as per some definitions, education is the prime tool for creating, adapting, and spreading knowledge in all disciplines of life. And knowledge is primarily related to all developmental efforts in advancing economic and social well-being in an emerging country like India. And moreover, the quality education has become a very important element as well as a matter of concern in the present time. Then comes the quality assurance. It is also termed as quality monitoring, has become a buzzword of colleges and universities across the world. It has different facets as they are responsible to the society for the products they produce. Coming to the history of this IQAC or the NAC Assessment and Accreditation Council, Bangalore proposes that every accredited institute should establish an internal quality assurance cell as a sustenance measure. So it is not a one-time activity, it is a sustainable activity and it is a continuous activity. So the IQAC will become a part of the institutional system and work towards the realization of goals of quality enhancement and sustenance. So in this connection, my presentation here attempts to highlight the role of IQAC in quality assurance, monitoring, sustenance and assessment of Indian higher educational institutions. Coming to quality aspect, the qualitative dimension means much more than the quality of education as customarily defined and judged by student learning achievements. In terms of traditional curriculum and standards, The World Crisis in Education, defined by Coombs in his book, The World Crisis in Education. The quality also pertains to the relevance of what is taught and learned, to how well it fits the present and future needs of the particular learner in question, given their particular circumstances and prospects. It also refers to significant changes in the education system itself, in the nature of its inputs, that is, teachers, students, facilities, equipment, and supplies, and its objectives, curriculum, and educational technologies, and its socio-economic, cultural, and political environment. So IKSE has become a game changer in all aspects of the institution building. And in another report called The Priorities and Strategies of Education by World Bank, the quality in education is difficult to define and measure. An adequate definition must include student outcomes. Most educators would also include in the definition of the nature of the educational experience that helps to produce those outcomes, the learning environment. And another important educationist, Dole, in 2014, in his role of assessment in improving quality in higher education. The finding of the study was that different innovative assessment methods have a strong lever for quality improvement in learning of substantive knowledge and skill and teaching various courses. The educators and instructors should plan the assessment processes systematically for the development of quality and standard of higher education. So coming to the function of IKSE, as you all know, it circles around the quality parameters. The first and foremost function of the IKSE is the development and application of quality parameters in various activities of the institution. So whether it is a KBN college or any other college, each institution has to develop its own parameters that are prescribed under the quality are key performance indicators. And dissemination of information on quality aspects is very important and foremost function of IQSE. Organization of workshops, seminars, and promotion of quality circles, a very important aspect. The quality circle. I suggest that every institution must have their quality circle, at least 5 to 6 quality circles on each aspect. Or you can define as per the 7 criteria of this NAC if you are going for accreditation. Or else you should have quality circles for academics also. And another important function is recording and monitoring quality measures of the institution. So many colleges are finding very difficult to, whenever they are going for NAC, is this aspect only. They are putting the records of any quality measures. So now I think when ICT model has come into existence for NAC assessment, it becomes very easy because everybody has to go in the digital way. So naturally the digital documents will be available forever. Earlier, this is not the case because everything is on the text and the records may be missing or records may be not updated every time. Now it is, in one way, it is a boon for colleges. In my opinion, it is very easiest way of doing going for NAC assessment because due to the digital age. And acting an agency of the institution for quality related activities. So IKSE, all the academic activities, research activities, and everything, all the administrative activities revolves around the IKSE only. So the principals and the management has to strengthen IKSE and its team to monitor the academics, to evolve better practices and also the evaluation process. It's a very important aspect for on the shoulders of the principals and the management to give full powers and freedom to the IKSL to function as a very eminently or very successfully. And last but not least is very important, that is the preparation of annual quality reports or annual reports, very important. So if every college or every IKSSL has this annual report perfectly, there is no panic to go for any accreditation by any other agency, whether it is NAC or any international agency like QS ratings or times higher education. In future, we are also planning to go for QS ratings also. So this is very important. Whenever and wherever there is no need for panic. So as I said, if you observe the previous slide, everywhere there is I highlighted the quality, the quality parameter, quality aspect, quality circle, quality measures, quality related activities, and quality reports. So NAC or QS agency or TIMES Higher Education, everything, anything that is assessing your quality or NRF, they are quantifying quality in terms of the outcomes. Right? So in this connection, you have to create a very important quality circle in your institution for each department or each criteria wise, or whatever that suits for your institution, you have to create a quality circle. And if you, as it is a recording in NAC or the IQAC, so it is better to have a criteria-wise convener and criteria-wise quality circles. And each quality circle should have 5 to 8 members team. It is a teamwork, but because everywhere you have to take all the stakeholders into the your stakeholders include students, faculty, alumni, parents, ministerial staff includes this team. So you please see that judicially the quality circle must function. And the metric-wise brainstorming, the criterion-wise groundwork, we have to done the criterion-wise groundwork. For example, if it is a quality circle for a curricular aspect, so you have to define every metric, you have to work on every metric, we have to address every metric like that. Before that, you have to work out. And metric-wise brainstorming, the entire team has to brainstorm metric-wise, and after the brainstorming only you have to go for filling the data. And after filling the data, even you have to double check the data and finalize each metric involving all the quality circles including the IQS coordinator and principal and management of the college. Right, this is very important. So the functioning of the quality circles are very important in every college, particularly when it comes to IQSC. Thus, IQSC has to play a very crucial role in quality enhancement of accredited institutions. The IQSC has to ensure that whatever is done in the institution for education is done efficiently and effectively with high standards. It is very important and foremost. The quality sustains in this education sector, which will mold the future of our upcoming generations, is a prime responsibility of our education system, which will be possibly only through continuous monitoring. It is very essential. The monitoring should be very continuous. So you have to plan before the academic year. You have to review in the middle of the academic year. You have to finally get the outcomes at the end of the academic year. So each year you have to plan, execute, monitor, and finally get the outcomes through only planning with the support of internal quality assurance cell of every higher educational institution. So IQSC is the harbinger of change. Now the prime task of the IQSC is to develop a system for conscious, consistent, and catalytic improvement in the overall performance of its institution. For this, during the post-accreditation period, institutions need to be channelize their efforts towards promoting holistic academic excellence, including the implementation of PATIMS recommendations. It is very important. I came across that many institutions have even lost the PATIM reports. So that is very pathetic situation. So it is very important to address the PATIM recommendations of the previous accreditation. What is IQSC vision? To promote quality culture. It is a culture. Everywhere you should have to promote the culture of the quality as the prime concern of higher education institutions through institutionalization. Institutionalizing and internalizing all the quality enhancing and sustaining initiatives taken with the internal and external support. So everywhere you have to involve all the stakeholders to improve the, to imbibe the quality culture of any institution, particularly the colleges. What is the objective of the IQSC? To develop a mechanism and to promote conscious, consistent, and catalytic action plans to improve the academic and administrative performance of the institution. And another objective is to promote institutional quality enhancement and sustenance through internalization of quality culture and institutionalization of best practices. It is very, very important and necessary to promote, to document, and to record all the best practices of any institution. So generally, as per the guidelines given by the NAC, the composition should be like this: a chairperson as the head of the institution as the chairperson, and it teaches to represent all levels, starting from assistant professor to the professor. If there is no professor, at least associate professor. So this composition should be like this. And one member from the management, the senior administrative officer from the office, and one nominee from the community or trust, and students and alumni. One nominee each from the employer, industrialist, and stakeholders, and one of the senior teachers as the coordinator of the IQC. Generally, what is happening is this committee is only on a paper, but really, in reality, the entire committee is not meeting at all in many cases in many colleges. But I request all the IQS coordinators, please see that at least this committee, the entire committee, the quorum of the committee meets at least twice in the year for each semester, so that you can involve all the stakeholders from the community, from the alumni, from your employers, from industries, etc. So plan to measure IQS effectiveness. You should periodically conduct a self-study assessment within your college as per your parameters. And this must be, assessment includes the internal as well as external. You can invite the external teams also to assess your effectiveness of your quality initiatives within your college, particularly the academics. And it must be cost-effective, and a process and performance benchmarking should be evolved. And you must conduct the gap analysis for every semester, and so that you can improve in the quality aspect, and you should have the improvement plan also after the conduct of the IQS meetings. Also, generally, your self-study components must include like this. So any mission must be in line with your vision of the institution. So many colleges, of course, now every college is keeping this vision and mission in their websites. If it is not there, please keep this in the website also. First, the question comes is it written document? So if the standards or the mission is following your vision of the institution, so consistent with the institutional mission and with best practices, you have to communicate to internal and external constituents. That must be visible and periodically reviewed and updated. Your mission and vision must be reviewed and updated if it is going in line with your vision or not. And the human resources, another component is human resource. Are human resources sufficient to meet the needs? Because every year, generally the institutions are updating their quality aspects, increasing in number, increasing their enrollments. So you have to assess that whether the available resources are sufficient, or you have to further recruit them. Do they have necessary competences to complete work? So nowadays everybody is asking about, talking about what you call the big data analytics, or artificial intelligence. These are the new courses that are coming in the field, and market is, there is a demand. So you have to recruit the new faculty members who are very efficient in these aspects, who have knowledge in this aspect. So this type of human resource upliftment must be done. Do they have necessary competences to complete that? So these departments must have the competences, or else you can train your existing faculty in this new knowledge. Are they providing with the professional development opportunities, that is clear job descriptions and assignments? Do they have time to reflect and act proactively? And do they have good working relationship with administrative and academic units? So these are all the human resources. This is a very important element where every management has to keep focus on this. And office resources. Next to the human resources comes to the office resources, where this is the backbone of every institution for its development. Do we have adequate hardware, software, and budget? And do we have assistance available for programming units, web design, statistical, and research methodology? Particularly, is the age of automation. So you have to focus on the automation of your entire office, where you can have the end-to-end solutions through this automation. And workflow, you have to see that the process of submission, work requests for accepting, assigning, and prioritizing assignments, use of tracking system to monitor progress, automation of routine reports, etc., must be done in a systematic and efficient and in a time-bound manner. And information access and retrieval. Ease of access to live and archive data, availability of data dictionary, process of ensuring data integrity and reliability. This must be ensured. And reports and other products. This is a very important aspect. At the end of the day, is measured on these reports only. So verifying accuracy, the distribution, availability of information on the web, and process of backup and security of the data. This is very important for any institution to grow. So these are some six self-study components which every institution must monitor regularly or periodically. Coming to the best practice benchmarking. So if you going for NAC or if you're going for NIF banking, if you go for QS ratings, everywhere there is a benchmark. So you have to meet benchmarks, or you have to at least come near to the benchmarking of any parameter or any criteria or any key indicator. So benchmarking is an ongoing systematic means for measuring and comparing work processes of an organization. The scene for benchmarking can be set by considering three fundamental performance issues articulated by the following questions, that is frequently asked questions, right? So this is the why, when, and how. The FAQs are like why, when, and how. So are we performing better than we have ever performed? So this is what actually NAC says with reference to your peer team report. So you have to upgrade from your previous grade. You have to always go further from your previous quality aspects. So this is one aspect. So you have to question yourself, that is, are we performing better than we have ever performed? And are there any other organizations that are performing well and from whom we can learn? This is second. First one is internal, second one is external. Are there any other organizations that are performing well and from whom we can learn? So recently we have organized a workshop, or a week-long workshop for NAC Going College. So we invited A-plus colleges to come and demonstrate their best practices, their benchmarks and best practice criteria-wise. So that's like that, each institution has to compare. For example, this college has to compare with A++ institutions, and they have to strive to get A++ ranking in the next assessment. So this is the external assessment, external competition. And are there any practices that will improve our performance? So why and when and how are the important pertinent questions to improve your quality? So coming to the types of benchmarking, what are the types of benchmarking? So here, there are different categories of benchmarking. One is internal benchmarking. What is internal benchmarking? For example, within your campus, there must be computer science department, there must be commerce department, there must be zoology, there must be physics, there must be chemistry. Like that, you have to organize some events. You have to organize, for example, you can organize which is the best department within your institution. So in uses of ICT, you can organize one event called annual event or semester-wise event called, you can organize who is the best performance performing department in usage of ICT, or in which department the MOOCs courses are highly enrolled by the faculty as well as students and get certified for certifications from the top institutes like Udemy or Coursera or edX like this, or even NPTEL or your MOOCs, CSU MOOCs also. So in this, you can take any example, or for example, you take a botany department is there, and how many projects are coming, or student projects are coming out from botany department, and how many student projects are coming from zoology department. Like this, you can assess within the internal departments. So it is called as internal benchmarking, internal benchmarking. So if you organize any competition, it must be within the competitive spirit only. Definitely, each department gets inspired from other department, and each department will reach its benchmarks, right? And functional benchmarking, it must be very functional. So this must be a competitive spirit, in a real spirit, and it must be a functional one. So there, this type of competition never be a damage to any other department. So you have to say that it functions very well, and there is a healthy practice, right? And competitive benchmarking generally focus on direct competitors who are the direct competitors. For example, it is external one. So your competitor, your nearest competitor is another college. You have to compete with another college. You have to take, you have to transfer the good practice from another department to another college institutions also across the globe or across India, right? And a generic benchmarks is undertaken with the external institutions which represent the best in class. So just I spoke about A++ colleges. Recently we invited A++ college, one coordinator from St. Joseph's College, which is A++ grade. So they have documented very perfectly the best practices, particularly the in criteria 7. So we inquired about that and we invited, yes, it is very important to emulate other best practices within the with the other departments, right? And best practice benchmarking is advocated for self-improvement. So it is always very important to have a competition with neighboring institutions or A++ institutions or A+ institutions to have your best practice to reach the benchmarking in quality assurance. Yeah, here I would like to give a caution. The good grade effect. The good grade effect is, it's like a syndrome. That means the Dutch Audit Chamber says that quality assurance schemes lead to three reports of the programs judged negatively according to the Dutch Audit Chamber. That means, of course, some colleges, I don't want to quote some colleges, some very good colleges, recently due to this, maybe a new ICT model, or maybe they are not acquainted with the new model, they have submitted their reports. What happens is, some colleges, they have lost A grade, some colleges, they have lost A+ grade, and some colleges, they went to B grade from A grade. And this is why is it happening is this because of good grade. But initially, well-rated programs feel no impulse for change or further improvement because of the good quality assurance results. So whenever a college stands like a good college or accredited with a good grade, they are somewhat lethargic. They're feeling experience some motor lethargy, and in the time frame, they are losing the good grades. So this is what is called as a good grade effect, and they're likely to more of the institution. They're likely to maintain the status quo. In the course of time, what is happening is that they are losing their grades also. So this is called as a good grade effect. So generally, what is happening is research says that a low-graded college or low-graded institution or any organization, they are improving, but highly-graded institutions, they are not improving, and in turn, they are losing the grades also. So there is a caution. I would like to give a caution to the top-grade college. Please work hard to at least stay back in this in your grades. And it is another psychological theory, that is a Peter Pan. So whoever are excelling, that is teachers, must believe in quality assurance for quality assurance to work. Institutional leaders will aim to create a culture. You have to create a culture. Everywhere you have to create a culture. Every department you have to create a culture. A committed culture, a committed team must be there in every department so as to improve your quality. A culture of excellence that will motivate and incentivize outstanding and innovative teaching. So you have to incentivize, you have to give some respect, some credit, or some importance to that motivated faculty, and give freedom to them so that they can do wonders in teaching, innovative teaching, research, institutional service, and community outreach from faculty members of all higher educational institutions and leaders. Impact of IQAC. So IQAC will facilitate that, ensure heightened level of clarity and focus in institutional functioning towards quality enhancement, ensure internalization of the quality culture, ensure enhancement and coordination among various activities of the institution. Of course, I already dealt with this. And the IQAC has to build an organized methodology of documentation and internal communication. So what is the process of quality assurance? It is a quality assurance process includes the process may have the following elements. The quality assurance of the student assessments, that is quality assurance by staff, of staff, quality assurance of facilities, quality assurance of student support, specific instruments for quality. Hello? am I audible? So instruments for quality check. These are some of the instruments to check your quality. That is SWOT analysis. SWOT or SWOC analysis. Every institution must periodically conduct this SWOC analysis. And intercollegial audits also have to conduct the information system. And you have to prepare the quality handbook also. Now, as I am dealing with the effects of IQSE across the higher education institutions in India, I would like to present some of the case studies of across the best colleges in India. This is one best practice of Brihan Maharashtra College of Commerce in Pune. They have the IQSE team within the college. They have designed a program called a Business Motivation Training and Research Center. So such programs has to be designed within your college by the IQSE team, with the help of all the departments, with the help of all the faculty, with the help of students, with the help of some startups, with the help of your alumni also. So here, it is one such best practice designed by Brihan Maharashtra College of Commerce, Pune. They have designed a course called a Business Motivation Training and Research Center, BMTRC. So the Business Motivation Training and Research Center has been set up with the aim of improving quality of commerce education within their college. It is a comprehensive project for bridging the gap between theory of commerce education and practice in the business world. So it is one of the best practices that they have documented, and many outcomes are there from the students there. Now the students have come up with good inputs and good knowledge, and they now have their own entrepreneur, their own startups. So such type of models can be innovatively designed by a IQSE team in any college. So as a case study, I took some of the best practices across Indian higher education. Another one is this one taken from Fatima College, Maryland, Madurai. So the teaching is participatory learning. They have implemented the participatory learning to make students totally involved in the teaching learning process. Techniques supplementing the traditional lecture method must be evolved. So this shift from traditional to innovative methods long back, they have practiced this long back, not during the COVID or just before COVID. So methods should make teaching an exciting and interactive exercise, and slow and advanced learners must benefit from the change and must be motivated to self-learn. So there must be a caution. So during the COVID, I think everybody speaking about the IT or ICT enabled teaching, particularly through Google or through flipped classrooms or through Zoom like this. So kindly, there is a caution that we have to take the confidence of learners, particularly even the poorest of the poor who may don't have these gadgets or mobile or networking. So you must focus on that in the wake of COVID-19 situation. The students must be participatory and not be passive targets. So towards this effort, teaching modules and lesson plans are organized and flipped classes were conducted. This is a practice, good practice long back at Fatima College, Madurai. So thrust for knowledge, Vignas is another best practice. It is taken from Kishan Chand Chalaram College, Churchgate, Mumbai. This college is practicing thrust for knowledge. They have titled this as Jignasa. I think recently, 2 years back, even Telangana CC also have adopted this practice at state level. So it is a science honors program. She is called as science honors program. It started from the second year BSc students belong to all science teams. Jignasa, the research volume of work done by these students was the culmination of Science Honors Program. The duration of the program is 1 academic year. The students are selected on the basis of a written test, and the participants enrolled in the program have to undergo an extensive training in developing the research attitude and carry out a small research project in their chosen subjects. The precise documentation of the outcome of their research endeavors is published in the research volume called Jignasa. It is another very important best practices. So as a case study, I am presenting here. And another practice is a Skill Wheel Club. The Skill Wheel Club is practiced at Maharani's Arts College for Women, Sheshadri Road, Bangalore. So The skill will come, what is it? It's like JKC. In our state, it may be called as JKC, but they have designed for their college, exclusively there for college. The goal of the program is to train students in communication skills and soft skills, such as reading, pronunciation, English speaking, writing, group discussion, job skills, and presentation skills. The Skill Build Club aims to train students in soft skills to empower them to compete in the job market. This is another best practice. Another case study taken from SCD, Government College, Ludhiana. It is tapping innovative ideas. It is very important best practice. What they will do is that the conceived idea of a student or faculty in a department is discussed threadbare, and then the HOD refers it to it for a discussion at IQS level, where it is evaluated for its relevance, validity, applicability, uses, stakeholders, and for the excellence. Now, it is then recommended to the college council for its documentation implementation. Hence, the theory becomes practice. The basic aim is to sensitize and involve the students towards the innovation. And of course, that may lead to entrepreneurship or startup. So this is another case study I took for presenting here, tapping innovative ideas. And they are documenting, they are promoting, and they are, of course, supporting up to the entrepreneur level. And of course, I am not present in full document here. They even organizing a meeting with the bankers also, so they can provide loans to the concerned project, and they will become a startup in the due course. And another best practice I took from another college of commerce, that is in Maharashtra. They have established commerce laboratory. The commerce laboratory was set up to enhance the quality of students on a sustained basis. So the commerce laboratory provides the students with an environment which is conducive to their all-round development. To encourage the self-learning process, the students through complete involvement in academic and co-curricular activities, broaden the scope of students' knowledge through continuous exposure to the practical world. So encouraging creative and innovative ideas is the motto. So developing organizational skills, communication skills, and leadership qualities, and providing a platform to the students to exhibit their business skills, etc. This also ultimately translated into an entrepreneurship. Okay, now coming to the very important model, a Japanese model called Plan, Do, Check, Act. It is it can be implemented in your quality circles. You may have 4, 5, 6 quality circles, and each quality circle has to plan first and do the activity and check, and finally it has to be implemented. So promote a small group activity in your quality circle and coach the teams to study the facts of a problem and prioritize top 3 concerns as a Kaizen improvement themes. Listen to ideas. It is actually a Japanese model. Quality circle has come from Japanese Kaizen model, and now it is implemented across education institutions and organizations, and even industry also. And finally, evolve PDCA, that is Plan, Do, Check, Act cycles, step by step, to achieve the benchmarks. Okay, this is a small caricature get you an idea of the impact of automation. So in every college now, there is a huge data from admission to the entire life cycle. Now NAC says that you have to keep the records, you have to keep the record of student, outgoing student, until he settles in the either job or entrepreneurship or either as an innovator, anything. So we have to map all the program outcomes until he if he went to higher education, you have to map the track. If he is in the employment track, and if he is becoming an entrepreneur, you have to track. So this cannot be done manually. So I suggest, and even NAC team says that automation must be there. Your office must be automated. Your library must be automated. Your admission process, your evaluation process, everything must be automated. And once it is automated, and in future, maybe NAC is also going total online. From, of course, now it is a 70% online. Maybe in future, there is a discussion going on, maybe 100% automation. So your IQS only tells your NAC score or your ranking in future. So try to make entire college from end-to-end automation is very important. Then you can relax. I think I have still more time. A planning, monitoring, and evaluation of accuracy. I would like to just briefly demonstrate how an IQAC team can work very efficiently from the beginning of the academic year till the end of the academic year. So here I just took the 7 criteria because it is a NAC and the IQAC particularly focuses on NAC only. So to simplify, you have to divide, it's called as a result framework document. I made it for a college level. Actually, results framework document is generally we make it for entire state. But even a principal and IQAC coordinator can devise this monitoring evaluation program for within your college. So it is called as a results framework document for college. So you have to divide each criteria into objective. And you have to give weightages, different weightages for keeping your objectives in mind. And you have to take an action plan, and you have a success indicator, and you have to devise units, and you have to keep time frame, different units for a different each unit, and again you have to give criteria weightages. So if you divide 100 marks into different weightages, then if you achieve more than 60%, more than 70%, it is better. If you achieve more than 90%, it is very good. If you achieve 100%, 100 out of 100, it is excellent. So try to, I request all the IQAC teams, try to achieve 100, at least beyond 90. So you can self-assess with your activities, with your record of works like this. So it is a simple brief explanation I would like to present here. So take, for example, curriculum design and development. It is very important aspect for any autonomous college, even for non-autonomous college also, in fact. So you give some weightages, according to the weightages, you can give weightages. For example, program outcomes, program specific outcomes, and course outcomes. This is very, very important key indicator. But if this key indicator is met within the timelines, for example, these outcomes has to be designed, has to be mapped during the board of studies time, during the academic council, and after the end of the your that year, academic year, you have to assess how it was perfectly implemented. So in that case, here, what I just broadly, I divided, I gave weightage point 10 marks for this program outcomes and academic flexibility. So if you reach both these, again, if mapping of POs, PSOs, and COs, you have done within that academic year, you can give the 5 marks weightage for that subtitle, the key indicator. And you have, if you have conducted BOS within the time and you have records, everything, you have submitted your minutes, and you can yearly, on a yearly basis, you can give 5 marks. So out of 10, you may assign 5 marks for each key indicator. And if it is fulfilled, you are succeeded. So you can score 100 by 100 year. Like this, you have to divide, you have to plan, you have to keep a plan. There is a strategic planning. This is a strategic planning at the beginning of the year. It is the beginning of the year. And like this, for curriculum enrichment, for feedback system, you have to evolve. For your understanding, I took this NAC parameters, 7 criteria, and broadly I divided this. It is not actually metric-wise. Okay. Coming to the second criteria, that is teaching, learning, and evaluation. You can give weightages according to your key indicators, and whether the progress is okay or satisfactory, you can assign that rating from 60 to 100. If you are not so comfortable or you've not achieved all the goals, you can give 60 score. Otherwise, okay, it is average, you can give 70. Good, you can give 80. Very good, you can give 90. And excellent, you can give 100 score. So everything is, if you plan properly in advance, it will be very easy. Nowadays, the ICT documentation is very easy if you plan properly. So like this, you can design your strategic plan before the commencement of the academic year. Now coming to the research, innovation, and extension. Like this again, you have to give the weightages, you have to give the success indicators, you have to divide the units, you have to give the weightages for each key indicator. And within the time frame, if you have completed that, for that period, the AQR is ready, kept ready with all the beautiful documentation. Coming to the infrastructure and learning resources, again, the same weightage, action plan, your success indicator, your units, even weightage within the time frame. Like this, you have to divide and you have to work on this, right? So student support and progression, student support, its progression, student participation activities, alumni engagement, like this. Governance, leadership, and management. I think I am running out of time. And finally, institutional values and best practices, right? So for every criteria, there is a key indicator, there is a different metric wise success indicators, and you have to assign weightages, you have to assign weightage marks, you have to define units, you have to frame timelines, and within the frame line, you please check that whether this is in progress or not. If it is not in progress, you have to review that. A mid-term review must be there with all your IQC team, with all your management, with all the departments, and see that it will be happened without any pressure or without any delay. So like this, you have to plan any IQC function very effectively. If you won't plan, this cannot be done overnight. So if you plan it, is you can make a AQR very beautifully submitted. AQR, you can develop AQR very beautifully, right? So with this, shall I close my presentation, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Thank you. Any queries, please?
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Now it's my privilege to propose vote of thanks to today's guest on vote of thanks on behalf of the college management to our today's resource person, Dr. P. Anil Kumar Garu. Sir has shared an extensive knowledge in applying best practices and creating quality circles for each department and criteria-wise convener roles. He also guided to create quality culture in enhancing quality education and also analyzed some case studies. By observing various colleges, such as understanding theory of commerce and practices in the business world, involvement of students in teaching learning process, tapping innovative ideas, impact of automation, and working system of IQAC with the good framework applied by you. Thank you, sir. Once again, I thank for having spared your precious time for all of us. Thank you very much, sir.
Madam, excuse me, madam, can I talk to sir, Anil Kumar, sir?
Yes, I think sir has left, ma'am.
Okay.
Now, the next